Today I want to talk to you about the hidden nature of God and the Wizard of Oz parable. It's been my experience that God is in the business of revealing himself in ways that are hidden if you aren't looking for them. And it seems that part of his nature to do this. If you aren't looking for the kingdom of God, then you will never see it. And the stuff of life is kind of like a big picture, and in it are hidden all kinds of signs of God's presence and his message for us collectively and also individually. God works on us like those pictures that we see, which are, you might see a forest scene, and at the bottom of the picture, it asks you to find how many animals are in the hidden picture. God works that way with us and with you. In fact, there's even a proverb that is hidden that tells us this is the way God works. Join with me in reading Proverbs 25:2. Here we go. It is the glory of God to conceal things, but the glory of kings is to search things out. Now, we are all kings, if you think about it. We all have our little kingdoms. Some kingdoms are bigger than others. Some of us serve our kingdoms better than others, but we all have kingdoms here on this earth. So we are kings in a sense. And it's the glory of God to conceal things, but it is the glory of kings to search things out. Now the truth is, God has hidden a great deal in the picture of life. And you better look for the kingdom in just about everything out there. It is all around us, but it is hidden. And it's hidden for a reason. It's part of our own growing and our own journey in life to seek after the kingdom of God, even if we ever see a glimpse of it just in Jesus. Just because you see the kingdom, though, does not mean that you're there yet. Jesus is the hidden God. He is the second person of the Godhead. He is God come to us in the flesh, but you can't see that nature. He is hidden from you. You see only a man, flesh and blood, a great teacher, a healer, a teller of stories, a prophet, but you don't see God unless God gives you enough sight through his Spirit to reveal Jesus, God's presence. God hides things. Jesus, the hidden nature of God, which is totally revealed for those who have eyes to see, taught in different ways. He taught in straight-up teachings, principles like judging others. He taught by example. He modeled what people should be and do. He revealed teaching through miracles like the feeding of the 5,000. For those who had eyes to see, they recognized at least some of his hiddenness. He also taught by stories. Pictures. We call them parables, but they are short stories and pictures in words, and he did it to hide things from those who couldn't see spiritually, and yet those stories or parables were very entertaining in terms of it. After he would tell the story, he had his disciples around, they asked why he was telling stories to entertain people. And Jesus told them. Read with me Mark chapter 4, verses 10 to 12, which is at the bottom of the page here. Here we go. And when he was alone, those who were about him with the 12 asked him concerning the parables. And he said to them, "To you has been given the secret of the kingdom of God. But for those outside, everything is in parables, so that they may indeed see, but not perceive, and may indeed hear, but not understand, lest they should turn again and be forgiven." Jesus said, you guys have got the secret of the kingdom of God, but those out there in the outside world don't. They see, but they miss a lot in the pictures. They hear, but they don't understand the hidden things. And so I tell stories, and if Father God wants to reveal, to open their eyes and ears, he will. And then he looks at his disciples and he says, "Don't you understand the parables, the stories?" And those guys look around and they're pooling their ignorance. A real brain trust. "Oh, yeah, Jesus, sure, we understand. We know." And, of course, they were in the dark as much as the people who heard the story. So Jesus tells them the meaning. Now, you need to understand something about the disciples The only thing that made them different from all these other people that are out there is that Jesus chose them. They're not intellectual giants. In fact, they don't have much on the ball at all. And the reason that they get to know what's going on is that in the picture of life, Jesus points out a few of the animals to them that are hidden in the picture so they can see them. And then they go, oh yeah, now I see. These guys aren't any different than anybody else. They are disciples because Jesus walked by one day and he said, I want you, you, and you, follow me, and I've got a job for you. And they said, oh, okay. Not knowing what they were getting themselves into. So don't think that they're any kind of big shakes because they weren't. They were chosen, that's all. Same thing goes for you and me. If God shows you things, then just remember, you aren't smarter or wiser or better than anybody else. He just chose you, and he has reasons for doing things, and most of the time, they are hidden from us. The only thing that you and I do is say, okay, I'm going with you, Jesus. Now, if you don't do that, then Jesus and the kingdom of God will stay hidden from you, and that's the way it is. So occasionally, Jesus would tell his disciples the meaning behind the stories. But you know, when we read the Bible, we read a story. You know what? This Sunday, we celebrate a resurrection story, don't we? The whole world knows about it. The Bible is full of stories. The story of Jesus, the story of Gideon, Samson, Abraham, Jacob, Joseph, a host of others. It is the Word of God in stories. And a lot of us say, hey, really good story. And we leave it at that. Like the crowds around Jesus, we see, but we don't perceive. We hear the stories, but we don't understand that God is speaking to us by telling us a story, thereby revealing himself to us and the principles of the kingdom. The Easter story is God revealing himself to us. And yet, a lot of people say, nice story. Today I want to talk to you about a story that is almost as familiar to us as the Easter story, and maybe for some of us, more familiar than the story of Jesus. And it's the story and the movie of The Wizard of Oz, which I did 8 years ago, but couched and hidden in that movie and the story are the two great commandments of God. And what I shall refer to as the Oz principle of life. Now, The Wizard of Oz was written by a Christian man named Frank Lyman Baum. Now, I know that he was a Christian. How do I know? Because you don't write a story like this without having heart knowledge of the kingdom of God. People have been writing stories to make points for thousands of years. Christians also write stories. C.S. Lewis, the great theologian of the last century, became known for his children's stories, like the Chronicles of Narnia and the Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. Anyway, Frank Baum wrote The Wizard of Oz around 1905, and in 1939, MGM made a movie of it. They did it to show a new technique of filmmaking, and that was color film. The Wizard of Oz made its comeback in the 50s with the advent of color TV, and the movie was used to sell color TVs. And you saw the NBC Peacock. And the contrast is so striking when Dorothy opens that door of her house and she walks into Oz in all the beautiful colors. Now, I remember as a kid, the first time I saw this movie on color TV. It was an amazing thing, color TV. So The Wizard of Oz had been around for over 100 years in story form, then in movie form, then as an annual event on TV, and it's still on TV occasionally. And it is a wonderful story, but there is hidden in it a message in The Wizard of Oz. Now, I have two scriptures printed which answer the questions of life, and they are about this movie. I want you to read with me Luke chapter 10, verses 25 to 28, which answers the question of life. So let's read it together. Here we go. And behold, a lawyer stood up to put him to the test, saying, "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And he said to him, "What is written in the law? How do you read?" And he answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, "You have answered right. Do this and you will live." Now this scripture right here gives the answer to eternal life. If you want eternal life, this is the answer. Love God with your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. Now, if you do that, then you live. That's the principle of eternal life. I'm going to call it the Oz principle. By the way, it's also the message of the great banquet, those of you who have been. The second scripture is Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 to 21 and verse 33, and I have it printed as well. Let's read it together. Here we go. "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust consume, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust consumes, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things shall be yours as well." This scripture right here concerns the guiding principle of the journey of this life. For you and me, seek first the kingdom. Don't put too much stock in the things of this world, because they're all going to pass away anyway. These two scriptures are what the story of the Wizard of Oz are really all about. Now, I'm going to go through the movie because I think most all of us have seen it. If you haven't, what planet were you born on? I mean, if you haven't seen it, or if you want to see it again after this, rent it, pay attention the next time it's on TV. Now, The Wizard of Oz is dream language, so it is full of symbols. It is a parable. The movie opens with a young girl, Dorothy, in a struggle over whether Elvira Gulch is going to take her dog, Toto. There's a storm in her life. There's a lot of turmoil. So she ends up in the backyard and she sings a song.
Somewhere over the rainbow, way up high, there's a land that I heard of once in a lullaby. Where the clouds are far behind me, where troubles melt like lemon drops away above the chimney tops, that's where you'll find me. Fly beyond the rainbow.
rainbow in the Bible is the sign of God's covenant with us. The rainbow is a picture of the many colors of God's love. It is the promise of the kingdom of God in our lives. And you can find that promise in Genesis chapter 9. She runs away, but meets a carnival man who convinces her to go back home. On the way home, a tornado blows through, and when she gets home, a window shutter knocks her out, and the dream begins. Tornado in this is in a dream are the unseen forces of power in her life. The flying house is her actually fleeing from her problems. She sees her problems in the storm. The house is a symbol of herself. The falling house is her falling from the certainty about things in life and the fear of not being in control of the things in her life. And the house falls on one witch, half her problem actually, but the dual nature of her problem, her external life problems and her internal struggle with how to live life. It leaves a second witch, the wicked witch of the West. And this is where the message of the gospel enters the picture. She opens a door. She opens that door. It looks like the Garden of Eden or maybe heaven. Color is everywhere. It's beautiful. It's peaceful. It's full of joy. And then it's full of children. Munchkins. It certainly isn't Kansas anymore, drab old reality in black and white, but it doesn't take long for heaven or paradise to be disturbed. The wicked witch shows up, or should I say Satan shows up, seeking to destroy that which has bruised his heel, as in Genesis.
You said she was dead.
That was her sister, the Wicked Witch of the East. This is the Wicked Witch of the West. She's worse than the other one was.
Who killed my sister? Who killed the Witch of the East?
Well,
was it you?
I'll bide my time.
And as for you, my fine lady, it's true, I can't attend you here and now as I'd like. But just try to stay out of my way. Just try. I'll get you, my pretty, and your little dog, too.
Now, as I said, the message of this movie, this story, is about seeking the kingdom of God and how we love God. Jesus said the only way that you can get into the kingdom is to become like a little child. Dorothy is a child. She's a young girl. And the first people she meets are children. And they give her direction to the kingdom of God or the New Jerusalem or Emerald City and God himself, the Wizard of Oz. They tell her to follow the yellow brick road.
But how do I start for Emerald City?
It's always best to start at the beginning. And all you do is follow the yellow brick road. follow the yellow brick road.
Follow the yellow brick road. Follow the yellow brick road.
Follow the yellow brick road. Follow the yellow brick road.
Follow the yellow brick road.
Follow the yellow brick road.
Part of the idea of heaven, we've always heard about it, is that the streets of heaven are paved with what? Gold. Yellow bricks. So the journey begins. And they tell her, you stay on the path, the way. Now remember, Jesus pointed out to us that the way you love God is with your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Dorothy represents the soul because she is a child. The child in each of us is our soul, and so she's off.
You're off to see the wizard, the wonderful Wizard of Oz. You'll find he is a wizard of wiz, if ever a wiz there was. If ever, oh, ever a wiz there was, the Wizard of Oz is one because of the wonderful things he does. You're off to see the wizard, the wonderful Wizard of Oz.
Now, the first person she meets on her way to the city of God, the Emerald City, is a guy hanging on a cross.
Now, which way do we go?
Pardon me. That way is a very nice way.
Who said that? Don't be silly, Toto. Scarecrows don't talk.
It's pleasant down that way, too.
That's funny. Wasn't he pointing the other way?
Of course, people do go both ways.
By the way, she comes to a crossroads. Right there. And this guy is hanging on a piece of wood. And he gives her direction, the scarecrow. Now, Jesus said, when you see the Son of Man lifted up on a piece of wood, then you will be drawn to him. Well, the scarecrow points the way to, really, Emerald City, the New Jerusalem. And by the way, the scarecrow is put in charge of Emerald City at the end of the movie. And like Jesus is put in charge of the New Jerusalem in the book of Revelation, in the kingdom of heaven. The scarecrow hung on a piece of wood is a picture of Jesus. But also a scarecrow in dream language is an illusion. He has no life, no spirit, no mind. And to many people in this world right now, maybe somebody sitting here, Jesus hanging on a cross, pointing the direction to the kingdom of God, is an illusion. Having no life. And the whole parable of the Easter story is just that. A story. It's an illusion. It's fable. Nice story. The scarecrow goes with her because he needs a brain. One of the ways you love God is with your brain. You love God with your heart, soul, mind, and strength. If you don't have a mind towards God, you miss some of the way in which we are to be in relationship with God. So the scarecrow represents loving God with your mind. Well, they go on and they pass through some apple trees, and there's probably a representation of the Garden of Eden and the forbidden fruit in the apple trees, and this is where they find Tin Man.
You're perfect, my neck.
Perfect? Oh, bang on my chest if you think I'm perfect. Go ahead, bang on it. Beautiful. What a necko. It's empty. The tinsmith forgot to give me a heart.
No heart?
No heart. All hollow.
Tin Man needs a heart in order to love God completely. You need to love God with your heart, which is your emotional side as well as your intellectual side. That's your brain. So Tin Man joins in the journey seeking the kingdom of God in Emerald City, the New Jerusalem. Next, they come to the woods, the dark forest. Woods in dream language, by the way, represents a place where you can kind of get lost in life. Lost in the woods is not understanding what life is all about. Heroes get lost in stories in woods, and they get torn and cut searching for the way through them. In The Wizard of Oz, it's lions, tigers, and bears.
I don't like this forest. It's dark and creepy.
Of course, I don't know, but I think it'll get darker before it gets lighter.
Do you suppose we'll meet any wild animals?
We might. Animals that eat straw?
Some, but mostly lions and tigers and bears.
Lions?
And tigers?
And bears.
Lions and tigers and bears. Oh, my.
Lions and tigers and bears.
Oh, my.
Tigers and bears.
Oh, my.
Lions and tigers and bears.
Oh, my.
Lions and tigers.
Now, they pick up the cowardly Lion of Oz in the woods. They gain strength in the woods where you get lost and you're afraid. Of course, this newfound strength is suspect at best. It really seems cowardly.
It's been in me so long, I just gotta tell you how I feel.
Well, come on.
Yeah, it's sad, believe me, missy, when you're born to be a sissy without the feminine vibe. But I could show my prowess, be a lion, not a mouse, if I only had the nerve. I'm afraid there's no denying I'm just a dandelion, a fate I don't deserve. I'd be brave as a blizzard.
I'd be gentle as a lizard.
I'd be clever as a gizzard.
If the wizard is a wizard who will serve,
then I'm sure to get a brain,
a heart,
a home,
the knife.
Oh, we're off to see the wizard, the wonderful Wizard of Oz. And here he is, the wizard of a wizard, if ever a wizard there was. If ever, oh, ever a wizard there was, the Wizard of Oz is one. Because of the wonderful things he does. We're off to see.
Well, now they have in the journey seeking the kingdom towards Emerald City, which is really the New Jerusalem. You have all the ingredients needed to get there. You have a soul in the child Dorothy. You have a seeking heart in Tin Man. You have a seeking mind in Scarecrow. And you have strength-seeking courage in the Cowardly Lion. And they're off to see the wizard. I don't know how many people have prayed, Lord, give me courage to do this or that. Anybody here? Lord, give me boldness as your servant. We all need a little courage in our fears. Well, Satan or the wicked witch throws a stumbling block in their way. They get off the path.
What are we waiting for?
Nothing. Let's hurry.
Yes, let's run.
Come on, come on. Hurry, hurry.
They get off the path. Poppies. By the way, poppies is where we get morphine and heroin, a few other drugs, opiates, all kinds of things, a number of drugs. So they get off the path and get on the drugs. Seems like a message someplace in all this. Or I'm just seeing things. Not only that, but they fall prey to those drugs, even within sight of the kingdom. Emerald City. They can see Emerald City, and they still get off the path and end up in a mess. But with a little bit of divine intervention, by the way, Glinda is an angel, not a witch. They wake up to where they are, and they get to the kingdom of Emerald City. There they meet the wizard, or his visage, and they are given a task to battle evil. Sounds like the Christian way of life to me.
What'd he say?
But first, you must prove yourselves worthy by performing a very small task. Bring me the broomstick of the Witch of the West.
But if we do that, we'll have to kill her to get it.
Bring me her broomstick, and I'll grant your requests.
Now, that's like the Christian way of life. No sooner did I discover the kingdom of God and enter into it than I was given an assignment. Go back into the world, bring me the broomstick of that witch. Go back into your world, struggle with the evil that is there. By the way, the name Dorothy means the blessed one. And aren't all Christians blessed ones? They have to go get the broom in order to complete what they started, which is to get to heaven in their own personal lives. So with heart, Tin Man, soul, Dorothy, mind, Scarecrow, and strength, Cowardly Lion, they go to battle evil or clean up their own life, their own world, you might say. Because you need to understand, this is Dorothy's dream world. It's her life. Getting the broom is the mode of operation by which the Wicked Witch functions, or the Satan functions. It represents getting your life in order. After you have received the kingdom of God through Jesus, the broom represents clearing away all that unneeded or harmful ideas, feelings, and habits. Anyway, they get there and get cornered by the Wicked Witch, and it looks as if all is lost. And then the miracle occurs.
Last to go, we'll see the first three go before her. And her mangy little dog, too. How about a little fire, Scarecrow?
No! 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 I'm burning!
Help! Go through that water!
Help! Help!
Ah! You cursed rat! Look what you've done!
Wicked Witch starts to burn the Scarecrow, the mind. He is also the Christ figure, by the way, in this story. Satan tries to burn the Christ. And Dorothy throws a bucket of water on the fire and hits the Wicked Witch, and she then melts. Melting. What a world. What a world. In the Bible, water is always the physical symbol of God's grace. We are baptized in water. We receive salvation. Our sins are cleansed. Water is the symbol of God's grace. When the children of Israel came out of Egypt, they went through the waters of the Red Sea to escape the evil of Pharaoh. It was God's grace that saved them. God baptized the world in water in Noah's day to cleanse the earth of evil. God's grace gets rid of the evil. Grace dissolves evil, much like water melted the Wicked Witch. They go back to the wizard. They find out that God is much like them in reality, but the real truth is that the kingdom of God is with you. I have Luke chapter 17, verses 20 and 21 printed, and I'd like for us to read it together. Being asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God was coming, he answered them, "The kingdom of God is not coming with signs to be observed, nor will they say, 'Lo, here it is,' or 'There,' for behold, the kingdom of God is in the midst of you, it's within you." Dorothy is told that she has always had the ability to go home, to be where her life is eternally based. The ruby slippers can get her home. In dream language, shoes represent the general situation of our lives, like we say, boy, I sure wouldn't want to be walking in her shoes. And your feet are the foundation upon which your life is built, your beliefs, actions, feelings, and love rest. Your feet also represent the direction your life is going. So Dorothy discovers, we all need to discover this, love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and those who travel with you. Make sure that the priority in your life is to seek the kingdom of God. And when you do, at the end, you will discover that in reality, the kingdom of God is within you and always has been. To paraphrase T.S. Eliot, we must not cease from our journey. And at the end of our journey of life, we will arrive where we began. And then we will know the place for the first time. Like Dorothy, when you seek the kingdom with your soul and your friends, heart, mind, and strength, you will discover in the end that the kingdom of God was within you all the time. There's no place like home, but you still have to make the journey. One P.S. to all this, anyone who has attended a great banquet has already been to Oz. The message of the great banquet is to seek first the kingdom of God in your life and to love God with your heart. Three talks on that. Relationship, discipleship, and staying power. All speak of loving God with your heart, loving God with your mind. The three talks are priority, study, and environment in which we live. All speak of loving God with your mind, loving God with your strength or your courage. The three talks that have to do with that, ministry of all believers, Christian action, and Christian community in action, body of Christ talk. When you get done, you're going to have an assignment, and that is to go back into your world and change your world. It is the glory of God to conceal things. It is the glory of people like you and me to search things out. One last picture I want to show you.
Yeah. Do not arouse the wrath of the great and powerful Oz. I said come back tomorrow.
If you were really great and powerful, you'd keep your promises.
Do you presume to criticize the great Oz? You ungrateful creatures, think yourselves lucky that I'm giving you audience tomorrow instead of 20 years from now.
Oh.
The great Oz has spoken.
Oh.
Pay no attention to that man behind the curtain. The great Oz has spoken.
Who are you?
Oh, I am the great and powerful Wizard of Oz.
You are? I don't believe you.
No, I'm afraid it's true. There's no other wizard except me.
You humbug!
Yeah. Yes, that's exactly.
One of the things that we understand within the Christian faith, but a lot of people don't understand, is that God became like us. He came to this world to show us how to live. He came to this world to take away the sins of you and me, and to show us the way, the pathway to eternal life. It's almost like this picture here. He became like us. And so they were not sure. I would like for you to close by reading Mark chapter 4, verses 10 to 12 again. Here we go. And when he was alone, those who were about him with the 12 asked him concerning the parables. And he said to them, to you has been given the secret of the kingdom of God. But for those outside, everything is in parables, so that they may indeed see but not perceive, and may indeed hear but not understand, lest they should turn again and be forgiven. This is just a story. May you see what's behind it. And by the way, you are living a story yourself. Remember to look behind it and see who is there. Let's pray.